glad to hear the fellowship, and thank you for being here. Welcome, everybody. We're going to go ahead and dive into the scriptures, and welcome, everybody. Glad that you're here, and so thank you for your zealous fellowship. The house is packed. Glad you're here. Welcome, everybody. Glad to have an opportunity to fellowship in the name of the Lord Jesus. And welcome, everybody. Glad you're in God's house. Well, by now, we've had our share of church. We've had some great worship exalting his name. We've had a baptism, Lydia's testimony, and you've had some wonderful fellowship. And I celebrate that you're here. You know, God's blessed us really every week with a number of new friends and new faces. And now that we're engaging the beginning of the ministry year and everything's kind of getting in gear, we had pretty much full service in the first hour, not quite this packed with the extra seats, but here we are today. And welcome back into the swing of things. And we're very glad that you're here. And it's time to consider what God says in his word. We've taken an opportunity in recent weeks to really pace ourselves through Philippians chapter 3, verses 9, 10, and 11. And today we get to verse 11. So we can celebrate that we're actually going to cover, by the grace of God, an entire verse in our exposition today. But your Bibles can actually be turning to Philippians chapter 3. Hopefully that is something you anticipate. I also want to give you a key to what it means to be a part of a Bible church. You see, Christianity is not a spectator sport. Christianity is an opportunity for you to grow in Christ. So associated with that, in the sermon time, we call people to bring something to write on and to write with, because this is a dialogue between you and God through the Word of God. So my job is to dish up the truth so that you can grow your conversation with God about what it means to know the truth, walk in the truth, live by the truth, etc. One of the primary ways that you do that is your active listening with pen and paper. And today is going to be no exception. We have a very important doctrine to cover called the perseverance of the saints. And there's going to be lots of scriptures, lots of Bible turning, and hopefully your Bibles are ready. Maybe pen and paper is at the ready so that you can record this. I intentionally give you more than you can handle in one sitting so that you're fed for multiple days. On purpose, I'm trying to bless you, feed you, encourage you. And here, this is one of the great purposes of the Grove, is to give you a theological superstructure so that you can build a life that glorifies God. Build an edifice for his glory so that you can know how to be married, so that you can know how to work for the glory of God, so that you can know how to fight those temptations online by the glory of God, so you can know how to relate to one another, so that all of your life is around and built around this edifice, this structure of theology. So we take our time. I preach relatively long sermons, but we do so that you can be established and stand strong in your faith. Now and today is a day to be strong in the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, to stand against the world, to stand against the culture. And the culture will be very casual about Christianity, and maybe here, there, and maybe a church a few times, maybe even church regularly. But is it serious about Christ and the Word of God? Well, we want to be. You know why? Because he's worthy, and we need it. So let's go to the text. Open your Bibles to Philippians chapter 3. We've been describing the Christian life as Paul describes it in these few verses. We've used an image that depicts this journey, the Christian journey about knowing Christ, as a series of mountains. This image here is one that we've used to give you an idea of this Christian life. And so we have the beginning of our Christian life is justification, or another way to say justification is our salvation. Our Christian life begins when we're saved, when we're born again by his grace. And then the end of our Christian life is our glorification. What happened? Where are we when we're glorified? We're in what place? We're in heaven. We're with Christ in heaven. So justification, us being saved here on earth, glorification is us finally making it to heaven. And in between our salvation and our glorification is an exceedingly important series of mountains called our sanctification. This is the Christian walk. This is Christianity, a Christianity that saves you by God's grace and then puts you on this exceedingly wonderful, challenging path, sanctification. And all of it is about knowing Christ. You see, the walk of sanctification, this series of mountains, is not for the faint of heart. It's not for those that maybe are wanting an easy path or a broad path. It's for those that are filled with the Holy Spirit in an image of eternal glory and are captivated by His glory to persevere through the challenges. Some of the portions of the hike are exhausting. Some of the portions of the hike are very technical. Some of them will maybe be on a spine where you're a little bit scared because to your right is this huge precipice and to your left is this falling off and who knows. And it's very difficult and very challenging along the way, but God is going to bring you through and it's ours to continue persevering through the walk. It's all about knowing Christ. It's all about knowing Him and the surpassing value of knowing Christ, being found in Christ, gaining Christ. Do you remember this language from this beautiful paragraph? Well, if you've opened your Bibles to Philippians chapter 3, it will serve us to read verses 9, 10, and 11. Philippians 3, beginning in verse 9. In fact, the phrase right before it says, "That I may gain Christ," verse 9. "And be found in Him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends upon faith, that I may know Him and the power of His resurrection, that I may share in His sufferings, becoming like Him in His death, that by any means possible I may attain to the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained it or become perfect, but I press on to make it my own because Christ Jesus has made me His own. Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus." So, just by way of review, what are the trail markers on the path of knowing Christ? Just reviewing what we've said over the last number of weeks, and all of this is found in verse 10. What are the trail markers on the path of knowing Christ? If our entire walk is knowing Christ, then how do we know that we're on the path of knowing Christ? He defines it for us in these terms in verse 10. Again, we've covered this in recent weeks, but just going back phrase by phrase, the first trail marker is that our need leads us to Christ's resurrection power. The first trail markers when we are exhausted and we then tap into His resurrection power. The second trail marker is our embrace of His sufferings. Do you remember that He says that I may share in His sufferings? It's an embrace. It's an understanding that walking with Christ is going to include suffering with Christ. And we embrace His sufferings. By way of review, again, what we saw last week was that a third trail marker on the path of knowing Christ is that our living looks like His dying. That our living, sacrifice, humility, and omission looks like His dying, humility, sacrifice, and omission. And the last trail marker that He gives us in verses 10 and 11, and then we'll receive some more, verses 12, 13, and 14, the last trail marker is our perseverance to the end. So if you're walking in life, and you truly want to know that you're on the path that leads to heaven, it's described here. His resurrection power to overwhelm sin and temptation in your life. Sufferings that we receive because we're walking with Christ and not according to the world. Living like His dying in humility and for the mission of Christ's glory. And lastly, the last trail marker, because if you're walking and you're hiking and you're not sure of the terrain and you want to make sure that the trail marker, that they reflect the ones that you want to be on. You have a map and you're like, I know I need to be on red. And which trail am I on? These are the markers for your Christian life. And if you have an interest in Christ, you need to know this information. This is how you can know if you're on the path to eternal life. Another indication is our perseverance to the end. Look again at verse 11, because what he says is quite interesting. He's talking about this path, and what does he say in verse 11? That by any means possible, I may attain to the resurrection from the dead. So the resurrection from the dead is in glory. It's in the future. It's in heaven. So in other words, the resurrection from the dead is us being called up into Christ's presence in the end. So he's saying that I need to exert myself and apply myself to whatever means are necessary. Any resources, any energies, any thoughts, I need to marshal whatever I need to marshal because I need to get there. When I hope in our hearts, we have to get there. I hope that we know that there are two eternal destinies that couldn't be different, more different from one another. There is a hell where the wrath of God burns against the unrighteous because they have failed to glorify the Lord Jesus Christ. And there is a heaven of praise, glory, service, purity, honor, and love forevermore. And I hope in recognizing that, what happens in your heart is happening to lots of our hearts, which is, I need to get to heaven. I need the resurrection from the dead. I need the prize, verse 14, of the upward call of Christ. I need to, verse 20, anticipate heaven, my citizenship in heaven, where I'm awaiting Christ Jesus, my Savior. And Paul says, since that is so essentially important, any means possible, whatever I need to do, that is going to be accomplished by the grace of God and by my earnest urgency. Do you see the terms of urgency here in verse 11? Again, so much in our world today with Christianity is so casual, spectator, consumeristic, maybe a little bit of here, there, but actually the terms of Christianity are far more urgent and desperate and essential than that. He's like, whatever I got to do, any means possible, I need to get there. So now we're talking about the doctrine of perseverance. So our title for the sermon is Perseverance of the Saints, How to Get to Mount Glory. He's talking about resurrection from the dead or glorification or heaven. And perseverance of the saints answers that question for us. Now, before we get there, I just want to highlight a set of triplets. And these triplets are fraternal, not identical. There are three doctrines that relate to one another, and they're not the same, but they're really closely related. Eternal security, perseverance, and assurance. And I want to take a moment just to show you these definitions. You can capture these. They'll be in the pulpit curriculum. You can print it out there later. But I want to do this because, again, these I-beams, I want you to understand the theology of the scriptures. We're talking about one of these three. In fact, we could talk multiple weeks about perseverance, multiple weeks about eternity. We could talk about multiple weeks about each of these. My point is they're related to one another. And so how are these three ideas defined? Eternal security is the absolute safety of salvation based on the character of God and the work of Christ. If you are in Christ, you are eternally secure because it's based on the character of God and the work of Christ. We're going to be highlighting some of those themes as we talk about perseverance. But perseverance is different than that. It's very closely related, but not identical to that, because perseverance is the God-given capacity to endure, abiding in the love of Christ and producing good works. So perseverance involves our activity, our cooperation with that power of the Spirit. We'll be defining that as we go through today because we're talking about perseverance. Now, assurance is defined as the comfort and confidence that the Holy Spirit deposits in the obedient believer. So assurance is a blessing. It's a gift of confidence and comfort. So there are at least three groups of people here today. There are some people that understand these truths and know that they're in Christ, that understand the gospel. They can define scripturally what it means to have a saving relationship with Jesus Christ, and you are confident and assured by the grace of God. Praise God that you have that strength. Pray for those of us that don't. Because there's a second group of people, and maybe you've been in church for a long time, maybe you've had lots of exposure to the gospel, but for different reasons, there's doubt or fear and anxiety about your salvation that may be chronic and long-term, and you lack assurance. But there's a third group of people that are here that are like, I'm kind of new to all this Bible-y stuff. I'm not sure really what's going on at this point. I know Jesus, I've heard of that guy, but something, I don't know what that is, and I'm new to all this, and you're asking the question, how does this relate? Well, the third group, the one I just mentioned, I'll just say this. We're defining here, Paul's defining what it means to be in Christ. This is the Christian life in one form of definition, and it's going to help us understand how true Christians continue on and persevere by the grace of God. For the second group, the group is familiar with these truths, or maybe you're trying to find gospel clarity and you're working through that in this season, or maybe you have it, but you're not sure if it's yours. I know that the struggle is acute, and I know that those fears are very serious, and we pray for you, and we love you very much. And these truths will bring comfort, and they also may bring a little bit of a sting when we get to the warnings. But all of this is designed to help you to look to Christ and to prize him as a surpassing value of all. And for that first group again, those of you that have assurance because you're blessed with a faith of obedience and a faith of fruitfulness and a faith of filled with the Holy Spirit and all that he produces in you, I praise God for that. Why don't you work with those of us that doubt from time to time and that struggle knowing his assurance? So these are three distinct doctrines. Today, we're just going to cover the doctrine of perseverance. Perseverance. So our outline is relatively simple. 3 points today. The first is we will persevere, the comfort of his guarantee. The second point in our outline is we must persevere, the challenge of his warnings. And the third is the mechanism of perseverance, how we get home. Okay? We will persevere, the comfort of his guarantee. We must persevere, the challenge of his warnings. The mechanism of perseverance is our third point. How we get home. How does perseverance work is our third point. We'll start here. We will persevere, the comfort of his guarantee. Okay, so a few of us about to enter this amazing storage room of infinite treasures. A few of us have privileged access to go through the door of these wonderful treasures of God's promises and God's character and God's word and God's presence and God's allegiance. Well, a few of us who are born again, who have the privileged access of being saved by God's grace, are going to come through this door to hear and know about and receive the full blessing of the treasures of his guarantee. Believer, he has guaranteed that you're going to make it to glory. He promises you, based on his character and his word, which never fail, that we will make it home. But there are some that are going to be left out looking through the windows, thinking, I would like to know those treasures and blessings. But you're on the outside because you're not sure that you're born again. Or you're on the outside because you're not sure that you have a right relationship with Christ. Let me just tell you this. Everyone can enter the past that those of us are privileged to have was a gift from the Lord Jesus Christ that he will give you today, the gift of salvation, the free gift of grace. None of us have earned that pass. None of us have achieved enough. So the guy's like, oh, I'll let that guy in. No. All of us were completely destitute and broken. And by his grace, he gave us the free gift of salvation so that we can come into the storage house of his promises and eat and drink to our fill. So if you're on the outside or if you're not sure that you have access, ask yourself this question. What does it mean to have a saving relationship with the God of this universe? What does it mean to be born again? What does it mean to repent of my sins, rejecting my sins would create a barrier between me and God? What does it mean to trust in Christ and his perfectly wonderful payment on the cross? The way to receive the free gift of salvation is through repentance and belief. And it includes words like confidence in Christ and dependence and reliance on Christ and allegiance to Christ, knowing and treasuring all that there is about Christ. I say all that to help you to know that if you're new to the gospel or you're new to the scriptures, it's our greatest privilege to help you come to gospel clarity. On Friday night, we had 55 young people at our clubhouse, at our churches, our 20s ministry, and 55. It was an absolute barn burner. It was a complete blowout. It was amazing. And I had more than one conversation that evening with some of the young people in your church, to clarify the gospel. I can't tell you how enriching that is. And all of us have those opportunities. I'm not uniquely privileged to have those opportunities. We can all be in ministry, all take those steps, all be in life groups, and all help others know the promises that he has for us. My point is to say, if you need gospel clarity, we're here to help you with that. We're here to make a disciple out of you as you learn what it means to have a saving relationship with Christ, because it would be our great privilege that every person here would have access by his grace into this storehouse and treasure of promise that is available to everyone that will bow the knee, repent, and believe. So what I'm about to talk about, this storehouse of promise, is for believers only, but believer, rejoice. He will bring you home. and for us to know this, and for us to love this, and for us to understand this, and for us to consume these promises. Oh, what a privilege. Now, I've done you a favor. Yesterday, as I was finishing my notes, I drafted 10 reasons that we know that we're eternally secure, and I'm giving you four of them this morning. So these are the cliff notes, and we can talk about a longer list later if that would interest you. But for now, how do we know that we will make it home? What are his guarantees to us that we as believers will make it home? Herefore, quickly, I'll give you these, we'll turn to the scriptures, and we'll cover these with relative brevity. The promise of Christ, John 10, 28 and 29. So I'm going to give you four reasons why God guarantees you that you will make it home as a believer. If you're truly born again, if you're saved by his grace, how do you know that you're going to make it? Number one, the promise of Christ, John 10, 28 and 29. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand. First, we have the gift of eternal life. Second, they will never perish. Third, no one will snatch them out of my hand. In fact, under the promise of Christ, you can consider John 6:39 and John 18:9, where Jesus himself says, oh, believer, he says about you that none will be lost. None. Has Jesus Christ ever lost anyone? Never. He knows all. He is inclined. He is prepared. He is capable. And you will be carried home by the promise of Jesus Christ. The second, number two, is the power of God. Romans chapter 8. I said these will come quickly. Hopefully you're able to record some of this and make it your own for a deeper study later. Each of these points are worthy of their own seminar or sermon. But in Romans chapter 8, verses 28 through 39, you can find no fewer than 8 or 10 arguments for the preservation of believers, that he will bring us home, and the guarantee for all believers is spoken of in many ways here in this passage, but I'll just show you verses 29 and 30. In Romans 8, 29 and 30, we have the unbreakable chain. Let's read it. Romans 8, 29 and 30. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. Those whom he called, he also justified. Those whom he also justified, he also glorified. Now, I know I'm coming at you quick, but let's just pause for a moment and see the unbreakable chain of redemptive history. When it talks about us being foreknown and predestined, that happened on the chronological timeline. That happened in eternity, what? Eternity past, right? So in eternity past, God foreknew us, God predestined us. And then in time, he called us and justified us. And what is the last word in verse 30 in Romans 8? Those he will also, what does it say? He will also, what is the last word in verse 30 of Romans 8? He will glorify. And glory happens where? In eternity future. So Paul says from eternity past to eternity future, the same exact group is foreknown, predestined, called, justified, and glorified. And no one is lost. This glorious power and plan of God, it's remarkably encouraging for those of us that are looking for a guarantee of our ultimate safety in him. Well, there's a third indication or guarantee that we're given. It's the protection of God, 1 Peter 1, 3 through 9. In fact, you can read that passage again. I'm giving you more content than we'll cover now. But in 1 Peter 1, 3 through 9, there's a beautiful paragraph that accents his protection. But I just want you to glance at verse 5. So if you're with me still, say, with you. And you might want to turn to 1 Peter 1, 5. 1 Peter 1, 5. So we're talking about the comfort of his guarantees. The first guarantee is the promise of Christ. The second guarantee is the power of God. The third guarantee is the protection of God. And I want you to see that in your own Bible. These are promises to every believer. 1 Peter 1, 5. Who by God's power are being, does anyone see it there, are being what? Guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. The NASB says protected. This is an amazing term. It's a beautiful, beautiful word. Let me help you understand a little bit. The word here, guarded or protected, is a military term for for a garrison or a protective unit in bringing an important person to an important place. I mean, anybody remember the Pope Mobile, right? And he's got the Pope Mobile and he's got his entourage and he's protected. Or imagine the president and his crew, his posse rolling into a joint. Like everybody's going to protect it. And I heard a story recently how in Copenhagen, the first climate summit maybe a decade or so ago, that all the dignitaries from all the nations, so like all the leading nations were gathering in Copenhagen for the first ever, we have to be serious about the climate. And all the presidents and parliament leaders were rolling in from all these different countries, and so they flew in their private jets, interestingly enough. But not only that, but they also brought cargo planes from all these different countries, and in the cargo planes were their own special limousines and their entourages. And so for the climate summit, very climate, as far as I'm concerned, they flew into Copenhagen. In fact, the airplanes overwhelmed the airports. There literally wasn't a place to land because there were so many airplanes, flying in, because they not only need themselves and their entourage and their cargo plane and their limousines. Why? Because when you roll in, you got to roll in big. You know what I'm saying? You got to have your limousine. You got to look good. You got to be in style for the big climate summit. Whether it's according to the world's leadership and maybe what is exposed folly there, we recognize that when an important person needs to get to an important place, a lot of times there's an escort. There's an escort. Believer, you are so important to God, He was willing to slay His Son on the cross to purchase your friendship and your love. And glory, Christ being glorified in heaven forever, is so important. God says, I'm going to make sure it happens, and I'll be the escort. When God guards your soul, you will make it there for sure. He is the escort. He is the guard. He is the protection from wherever you are to glory for certain. And the path that you're on and the mountain part that you're climbing, I hope you're not climbing alone. It may be difficult or challenging or scary or beyond you, or you may be exhausted, but God is there to bring you along the whole way. You are guarded by the power of God. And if you're guarded by the power of God, you are guarded indeed. And these are promises and guarantees from God for our souls. And we thank Him for it. The promise of Christ, John 10. The power of God, Romans 8. The protection of God, 1 Peter 1. And fourth, the presence of the Holy Spirit, 2 Corinthians 1, 21 and 22. 2 Corinthians 1, 21 and 22. So now, if you look at that list, who's involved in guaranteeing that you get to heaven? What are the names of the people? What does it say? Who? Jesus Christ, that's number one. And who's in number two? God the Father. And who's in number four? The Holy Spirit. Oh, so you have the full advocacy of the Trinity promising, protecting, and carrying and bringing you home. In 2 Corinthians 1, 21 and 22, feature this very beautifully. It is God who establishes us with you in Christ and has anointed us. So God and Christ are here in the mix in verse 21, 22, who has also put His seal on us and given us His Spirit in our hearts as a guarantee. His Spirit has sealed us for eternity. What is the last word in verse 22? For it is what? Think back over the eons of eternity, time and epochs. Think back through the epochs of human history. Just think back over your life. Has God's promise failed once? It hasn't, for none of us. And when God says it's guaranteed, and when God seals us with His Spirit to be guaranteed for heaven, it is sealed and guaranteed for sure. Not only the Father and the Son, but the Spirit all working together to bring you home. You will make it home. What a comfort. What a glory to receive these encouragements that fill our hearts with and steal our resolve to move forward. J.I. Packer says this, "You are not strong enough to fall away while God is committed to holding you fast." I'm just not strong enough. It's just that simple. You're just not strong enough to fall away when God is committed to holding on to you. And he's committed to holding on to you in his Son, for the glory of his Son, the promise of the Son, the power of God. I want those guarantees to wash over your believing but anxious and doubting soul. We will persevere. The comfort of his guarantee. But there's more in the doctrine of perseverance. It's we must persevere the challenge of his warnings. We must persevere the challenge of his warnings. Now we're going to move to a different set of challenges and warnings in the Word of God. And these warnings sound threatening. They're scary. They don't feel good. I get it. When we hear warnings from the mouth of Jesus, when we hear warnings from the book of Hebrews, when we hear warnings from Paul in Colossians 1:23, when we hear these warnings, they threaten us and they feel scary. So why would Jesus ever offer them? In other words, if we're secure forever and we're not going to lose our salvation and it's not possible to do so, then why would he offer warnings at all? Well, I want to answer that question. And I think this will help you understand why they're in the scriptures. And then we'll look at a few warnings as we understand how we must persevere. Because perseverance not only includes the promise of God, but it includes our choices, our determination to carry on. Let me use the illustration before I answer the question about why these warnings. As God is our garrison, as God is our escort on the journey, I truly believe that the journey includes our willingness to take the next step. He doesn't carry us on a feather bed of ease or passivity to heaven. We choose to take steps forward. You choose to come to a Bible study on Friday night. You choose to make church a habit. You choose to join a life group and to make disciples. These are choices that we make on the journey because these are acts of faith as we submit to God. And so the doctrine of perseverance includes how we are active in this process. But why the warnings? Because I know they don't feel good, but why? First, they help define saving faith. I hope you understand that saving faith is a very important doctrine that is very full. In the casual McJesus church of today, faith is very simple. Ask Jesus in your heart, and that's it. That's kind of the whole thing. That's not true at all. Ask Jesus in your heart is not biblical. That is not in the scriptures. It's actually not a very good understanding of what it means to actually receive salvation. My point is, in the McJesus church today, it's very casual and very even consumeristic. You just do that thing, and you're kind of fine. But actually, the Bible defines saving faith in much more rigorous and detailed terms. It's actually quite extraordinary. The aspects of salvation. I listened to a few of those a moment ago, from reliance to confidence in Christ and not in the flesh, and dependence upon him and allegiance to him. So one of the reasons why these warnings are in place is because it helps us to define saving faith. Let me say it this way. True saving faith necessarily has the attribute of perseverance. Well, 1 John 2:19, you'll want to jot this down because this will probably be like a keystone of understanding for some of you. 1 John 2:19 says it powerfully. It says, "They went out from us," talking about people leaving the church or apostatizing. "They went out from us because they were never of us. Because if they were with us or of us, they would have remained with us." 1 John 2:19. Very interesting. John's point is the reason why they left is because they were never with us. They never had true saving faith. They maybe looked the part. They maybe had an external showing. That's why some of the ministries here at the Grove are so intentional about relationships and disciple making, is because there are people that come at the church, to the church, and they're around and they do the stuff. And then years later, they apostatize. They literally reject Christ and they turn away from the gospel. On purpose, they say, "I don't want anything to do with that." That's apostasy, and it's an indication that they were never truly born again. 1 John 2:19. So, why are these warnings in the scriptures? Because they help us define saving faith, number one. Number two, their purpose is to evoke faithful engagement. These are inducements to faithfulness. They put a skip in our step. They enhance our pursuit of Christ. Let's use another hiking illustration. Let's say we're all on a path and we're hiking, and we come to a fork in the path, and on the one side it says, that destination is glory, joy, protection for you and all that you love, and eternal bliss forever. That's this marker in this direction. And the opposite direction is pain, shame, no satisfaction, misery in time and for eternity in that direction. I hope all of us instantly would head right and go as fast as we can away from that and in this direction. This sounds so wonderful, and it's so compelling, and it's real. Heaven and hell are real. And when we have a fork in the road, these warnings are like, don't go that way. That will lead to destruction. This way leads to eternal life and blessing and joy forever. You see, these warnings are an inducement to faithful engagement. They're in the scriptures to say, no, not that path, and no part of that path. And in fact, when you come to that fork in the road, how many of us are like, I'm not sure. Oh, interesting. Why don't I just stay here for a while and figure out which way? Maybe there's a path I don't see kind of in between, because I don't really, some of this, I don't want to go to hell. But I mean, do I really want to do the Christian thing so much? I'm not so sure. So, none of us would do that. That would be called foolish. But instantly, that path for Christ and for his glory, it's an inducement to engagement and purpose. And we hear that within Paul. He's like, by any means I may attain to the resurrection from the dead. He's like, I'm all in on that path. I'm totally committed to what God calls us to, which is this energy, this pursuit, this joyful approach of Christ in knowing him better. That's exactly what you have in verses 12, 13, and 14 of Philippians 3. Paul's like, hey, if by any means I may achieve the resurrection from the dead, he's like, yeah, that's pursuing this. It's going on this path. It's going with all my might in the direction of Christ and his glory. And we'll be studying that in the weeks to come. So that's the second reason. It's a faith inducement. It's an inducement for our engagement. The third is this, the means to the end. It's important theologically to recognize that God ordains the end, that we will come to heaven. But he also ordains the means. And the means include our choices. The means include our commitments. The means include what we do and how we do it and where we put our resources, our time, our energies, and our desires. And so God ordains the end that we will be in heaven, but he ordains the means as well. The end is secure by his grace, and we will reach glory by his grace and grace alone. But the mild mystery of compatibilism is that while the ends are guaranteed, they're fed by the means of perseverance. The ends and means. So yes, he's going to bring us home, but what are the means of us getting home? He doesn't just take us in a helicopter to glory. He brings us on this narrow path. It may be treacherous. It may be daunting, but it is satisfying. And he fills us with his spirit, and he strengthens our feet and our step to be faithful to him, hating the world, rejecting sinfulness, and pursuing him with joy. All right. Now that I've kind of softened you up a little bit, let's look at some of these warnings. These are a little bit stout, so prepare yourself. Matthew 24, 13. I would offer you John 8, 31 as a reference you can jot down, talking about abiding or continuing to abide, and those are his disciples. But Matthew 24, 13 will give us one warning from the mouth of Jesus Christ. Matthew 24, 13. And we could do a series on the warnings of the scriptures, but maybe that for another time. Matthew 24:13. This is a warning from Jesus. And it may shock you because you're not familiar with this from Jesus' ministry necessarily, but Matthew 24:13 says, but the one who endures to the end will be saved. He puts a condition on it. Puts a condition on it. Those who endure to the end will be saved. What he's doing again is he's defining saving faith. Those that have saving faith will endure to the end, is his primary point. But it's also an inducement to endurance, to perseverance. I mentioned Colossians 1:23 and Paul's ministry, but why don't we go to Hebrews chapter 3 for another couple warnings. Hebrews chapter 3. In fact, Hebrews is quite an extraordinary book. It's organized around five different warnings, very strong and stern warnings about people that are languishing in their faith or not moving to maturity. Very interesting. But here in Hebrews chapter 3, two of these warning passages are given about the need to endure or the need to persevere. So John 8:31, Matthew 24:13, Colossians 1:23, we didn't look at all those, but now we're in Hebrews 3, 6 and 14. Hebrews 3, 6. But Christ is faithful over God's house as a son, and we are his house if indeed we hold fast our confidence and our boasting in our hope. So the author of Hebrews, I don't think Paul wrote Hebrews. The author of Hebrews is saying, yes, God is faithful over his house, but just pause real quick. Are you in his house, is what he's saying. Are you truly for that? Because if you're in his house, then you will do what? You will hold fast our confidence and boasting in our hope. That's the person that's truly in the house. Look at verse 14 as a parallel admonition or warning. For we have come to share in Christ, and he's saying that you're a Christian, that you're born again. We have come to share in Christ if indeed we hold our original confidence firm to the end. And he's making a point about perseverance to the end, all the way through, holding on, laying hold, holding fast to the confidence and hope that is available in Christ Jesus. Life is hard. These challenges abide. There are many temptations to lose our confidence or lose our hope. Take up your hope. And in the fellowship of the saints, encourage one another to take up your hope. You can actually keep your finger right here in Hebrews 3. We'll be back to it in a few minutes. Because there's the, how do we keep on our hope? Keep our hope? It's right here in this passage, and we'll be back to it. But we need to take up our hope, and we need to persevere. Life is hard. We need to persevere. And in a moment, I'm going to tell you how to persevere. Because this is not a try harder, do better, be better sermon. No good sermons are that. All sermons are look to Christ, and he is our salvation. More on that in a second. But when life is hard, we need to just carry on by his strength and for his glory. We took, while we were in Honduras, the six of us that were there on that missions trip last week, a week and a half ago, we took a hike. And there's a picture from the end of that hike, and I'm on the end because I was the last one. And if you could tell, my shirt is absolutely drenched, soaked with perspiration. There was not one dry portion of my shirt for me to dry my sweaty brow. It was quite uncomfortable. It was quite a hike. We climbed to the top of Mount Sinai, and that's literally the name of it. And I had an experience with God on the top of that mountain. On the way up, I took the lead for most of the time because I was fearful that if I didn't, I would be left for dead. And so I was like, I'm broad enough to just clog most of the path that they can't get past me. And so I just kind of went on. And then we would get to a vista point. There would be a bench and there would be an outlook. And I wasn't so interested in what to see. I was just interested in catching my breath. I would plot myself down strategically on the end of the bench and I would just breathe as if my life depended on it. I was just huffing and puffing. And behind me, there was Kevin who was reading Psalm 104, and then Ricardo's like, oh, I should read it in Spanish to our guide who doesn't speak English, and then Kevin is looking at the flora and fauna and taking pictures for his mom, and this is a beautiful flower. I didn't care about any of that stuff. I just needed the next step in front of me. I was so tired. It was so exhausting. I just needed the next possible step and the energy by the grace of God to lift my foot up again and to march my way up this mountain. It was quite a feat, at least for me, and we made it, and we made it down by the grace of God. The truth is that life is hard and life can be challenging. I'm here as your brother and sister to plead with you to take the next step. Take a step forward. I don't know what that looks like in your faith or in your life, but take a step forward. Maybe that means reading the Bible tomorrow and getting some accountability about a reading plan. Maybe that means finding a Christ magnifying church where you can commit and give and serve and be a part of the ministry. I'm not sure what your next step forward is, but whatever it is, take that step. Press on. Press forward. Persevere. Persevere. So how do we persevere? What's the mechanism of perseverance? Let's cover that briefly. How we get home The mechanism of perseverance, again, it's not a try harder or you have failed or you need to do more sermon. Sermons aren't like that. This is a sermon that calls you to esteem accurately the all-surpassing value of knowing Christ and calls you into the promise and the joy of his presence. And he has made you his own. Philippians 2:13. He's made you his own. And so just enjoy that presence and that power that's with us. So what is the fuel for our perseverance? How do we persevere? How do we endure? Look to Christ. Hebrews 12:2. Did we in our own strength confide, our striving would be losing. We're not the right man on our side, the man of God's own choosing. You ask who that may be? Christ Jesus, it is he. Lord Sabaoth, his name, from age to age the same. And he must win the battle. Hebrews 12:2. I hope you're there. This is so powerful. Looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith. The founder is the initiator, the author, the one who started it. He's the author of our faith. We're saved by him and because of him. And he's not just the author. He's the what? He's the finisher. He's the perfecter. He's the one that makes it happen and brings us home. Look to Jesus Christ. I don't know what vexes you. I don't know if it's that horrible temptress online. I don't know if it's that anger with your workmate. I don't know if it's worldliness. I don't know if it's compromise. I don't know if it's doubt. I don't know if you're anxious about something. I don't know if you're frustrated about a relationship. I don't know if you're upset because you have something that you don't want or don't have something that you desire so badly. I'm not sure where and how you're vexed, but all of you can look straight to the cross and look to Christ. He is our satisfaction. He is our all. He is our grace. He's the one that gets it done and brings us home. He's the strength. He's the power. Look to Christ, the author and finisher of our faith. And while we may be tangled up in difficulties, chapter 12, verse 1, and it may be hard, look to Christ. That's the fuel for our perseverance. Augustus Toplady, a hymn writer from 350 years ago, says this: from whence this fear and unbelief? Hast thou, O God, put to grief thy spotless Son for me? And will the righteous judge of men condemn me for the debt of sin which you, Lord, has charged to thee? Complete atonement has been made, and to the utmost farthing paid whatever thy people owed. How then can wrath on me take place if sheltered in thy righteousness and sprinkled with thy blood? Look to Christ. He's paid it all. Trust in him. He is a worthy shelter for whatever ails your soul. Look to Christ. What's the fuel for our perseverance? What's the mechanism of our perseverance? Number one, look to Christ. Number two, listen to his word. Psalm 119, verse 28, my soul melts away for sorrow. Strengthen me according to your word. Psalm 119, verse 28, my soul melts away with sorrow. What's gnawing away at your soul? What is causing you to doubt and fear and hedge the bet or compromise? Whatever melts away your soul, God's word will strengthen you to the core and steel your resolve, not with a John Wayne, I'll figure this out on my own stubbornness, with a yielded, submitted God, you show me the way and you fill me with your grace so that we can move forward. We have to move forward. Glory's waiting. But if by any means possible, whatever is necessary, Paul says, that we attain to the resurrection from the dead. So we look to Christ, we listen to his word. John 17:17, sanctify them in your truth, your word is truth. The third fuel or mechanism for perseverance is to receive the strength of God's people. I mentioned Hebrews 3 would be meaningful. Again, if you're still there, you can turn back. Or if you're still there, you don't need to turn back. Thank you. If you're not still there, you can turn back to Hebrews 3, 12 and 13. Because in the middle of these two warnings is this beautiful answer to how we then continue on in faithfulness. Hebrews 3, verses 12 and 13. In the middle of these warnings, he tells us how we then move forward in perseverance. This is powerful. The point here is receive the strength of God's people. Hebrews 3:12, take care, brothers, lest there be in any of you an evil, unbelieving heart leading you to fall away from the living God. But exhort one another every day, as long as it is called today, that none of you may be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. What a remarkable passage that challenges us to exhort one another, to challenge one another, to love one another, to care for one another, to partner with one another, to comfort one another. But as long as it's called today, be there for one another. And if we're going to persevere, we need the strength of God's people. Don't ever go alone. And don't ever think that your journey alone will be successful. It's not designed to be lived alone. It's designed to be lived in community, where we can look you in the eye face to face and just say, friend, brother, just sister, let's move forward together. Let me help. Let me short rope you. Let me build you up. Let me encourage you in the way. Since time is limited, there's a fourth mechanism of perseverance. Look to Christ, listen to his word, receive the strength of God's people. And number four, look forward to heaven. I'm absolutely struck here in verse 11, Philippians 3:11, Philippians 3:14, Philippians 3:20, a primary encouragement for Paul's determination that he's keeping on going is a mind fascinated and fixated on Christ in heaven. I mean, he says resurrection from the dead, verse 11. And then he says, verse 14, the prize of the upward call in Christ. In verse 20, he talks about awaiting for our citizenship in heaven where Christ is. We need to have our hearts and minds set on Christ, seated at the right hand of God. Not on the things of this world, but things of Christ. And that's how, looking forward to heaven, we are motivated, looking to Christ, listening to his word, the fellowship of the saints, and looking forward to heaven. In the waning hours of World War II, the USS Laffey was a target of the Japanese last attempt. This is April of 1945. You'll remember that Japan at this point, to a great extent, is flailing in their attempt at holding on to their region. The American Navy, the Marines in particular, were just overwhelming island after island. Hiroshima was August 6th, so this is a few months before the end of the Second World War in the Pacific Theater. USS Laffey was a part of a naval brigade, and this is a destroyer. It was commissioned at the end of World War I and was a fine and fit and amazing naval vessel. Well, on April 16th of 1945, as I mentioned, it became the target of a kamikaze attack. You'll remember that the kamikaze attack is the divine wind, and it was the Japanese last effort. While we don't have any bombs, we have people, and we're going to use planes as bombs. And so 50 planes were designed to take down the U.S. Laffey, 50 airplanes to attack it, first with its bombs and strafing, and then finally at last ditch with the planes themselves, with the pilots committing suicide. Well, 28 of those 50 planes were shot down and approached by our Air Force. Of the 22 that made it to the range of the ship, 15 of those were shot down by the ship itself in its approach to the boat. But 7 of them hit the target. 7 airplanes hit this ship, the USS Laffey, on this day. And it was absolute mayhem. It was, you can see from the image, the smoke and the damage and the difficulty. This is the ship that would not die. It wouldn't quit. And there was fire and inferno on all sides. And the stories of heroism from this remarkable day in American military history are quite amazing. One sailor explained, I'll never forget, we had our morning alert and had gone down to breakfast. They had been out, and there was a first surge of these airplanes, and a few of them had come, and they had neutralized that threat, and so they went down for breakfast thinking that the fight was over. It was especially good that morning, but then the general quarter sound, and I figured we'd come back to finish it later, that we'd go back up for a skirmish and return. We did not get below again for 2 days. When we shot down the first planes that attacked us, we thought that was all that there was, and they kept on coming, but we couldn't get them all. Once we had maybe a few minutes, I started to light a cigarette, but one plane was right on top of us before I could strike the match. Just plane after plane after plane, just attacking and attacking and attacking. The chaplain comforted one soldier who was distraught. He says, "We're all scared. You'll have enough backbone." And your Savior and God says that. You may be scared. You may be exhausted. It may be difficult. It may be treacherous. There are means for your perseverance. And you will, by my grace and through my power, have the backbone to persevere. Everyone was scared, but they stuck to their positions. If people could see what I saw, they'd stay at their jobs as long as the war lasted. I remember one fellow in Mount 25. He was still in his straps, even though both of his legs were gone. And he sat there at his work, at his post, carrying on. You will persevere, and you must persevere. Look to Christ, listen to his word, enjoy the strength that the believers around you supply, and look to heaven in all of your ways. We want to end where we began, with a note of glorifying Jesus Christ for his power and honor. I'll quote again from Augustus Toplady. Hopefully this antiquated language isn't beyond you. Hopefully you read enough Puritans to track with words like this. It's beautiful, encouraging you to persevere. "My name from the palm of his hands, eternity will not erase. Impressed on his heart, it remains in marks of indelible grace. Yes, I to the end shall endure, as sure as the earnest has been given. More happy, but not more secure, the glorified spirits in heaven." You are as secure as those that are already in heaven, protected by the power and promise of God. Pray with me. Father, we love you, and we want you to be honored. While these warnings are stern and somewhat scary and frightful, we run to Christ and we look to Christ, and we're glad to receive from his word, from his promises, from his presence in the power of the Spirit, the great assurance and encouragement that is available to those of us that have trusted in Christ. What a remarkably wonderful storehouse of your power, and we receive it, Lord, because we need it. And while we may be exhausted or tempted, Lord, we know that you'll bring us home, and we thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.